fucking score.
Man, I'm not gonna lie, I'm fucking cooked.
There you go.
Here.
Oh, there you go. Oh, let's go.
Oh.
No, of course, you fucking
oh
animal.
God.
Let's go. Let's go. Every day I spend my time drinking wine, feeling fine. Welcome to Bourbon and Bud, everybody. We appreciate you hopping in for another episode. We are recapping, or not recapping, we're previewing and predicting the next fight night, Blanchfield versus Fiorot. It's UFC Atlantic City, New Jersey. One of the betting, the second betting capital of the world. We're excited to watch it. Fuck you, Square, for that little face you're making right now. We can't all be perfect. But we're going to be talking about a few of the fights on the card, a couple of the main card fights and a few of the prelims as well. We're going to be talking about Andre Prochaska, Jacob Malkoon. We'll be talking about a little bit about Werner Jandiroba, Lupita Godinez, and then we are going to talk about Nate Landwehr and Jamal Emmers. And on the main card, we'll be touching on every fight on the card, but we're going to be brief about a couple of them just because we all probably feel like we know how they're going to go. Should be a relatively quick episode, we hope. We always say that, and it doesn't end up being so. We'll hold on to every co-host as long as we can. I know Square's got a limited amount of time. Coop's probably got a limited amount of time. We'll keep it as expedited as we can. As always, we appreciate every follow, subscribe, like we get. You guys are awesome. We started this thing over a year ago and couldn't imagine it would ever get to this point, much less where we could go from here. Keep in mind, your boy Max and Squared will be in Louisville this weekend for LFA 180. We are stoked for that fucking car. We cannot wait. We'll be heading down there Friday midday, grabbing some dinner and heading out to the card. So we hope anybody that watches this, that'll be there, lets us know, and we'll either link up with you there somewhere after. We're going to go to some bars afterwards, try to link up and, you know, network where we can. And of course, we got to watch Tennessee, you know, get the dub over Creighton. But hell yeah, happy to be here. Knuckles, what's up, man?
Back again for another episode. This makes like however many, but I'm pumped. I'm looking forward to this card. I think it's a good card all around. There's some okay fights, some fights, and then there's some really good fights as well. But I think a lot of this card is fairly straightforward, but it should be fun because there is some variations as well, and I'm fucking pumped. Excited for you guys to go to LFA this weekend. Wish I could be there, but, you know, I live in an entirely different state, so it's a little difficult. But I will be going down to Nashville, though, for the UFC 300 card, so maybe y'all can fucking catch me someday down there sometime. I don't know. I'm going to be spending a lot of time with the boys, but, yeah, fucking I'm pumped, dude. Ready for it. Fucking ready to break down this card. Coop, how you doing, brother?
Doing good, yeah. Excited for a nice weekend of fights. We got some we got some bangers on tap. I'm really excited to see how that main event comes out because that's likely your next title challenger after Valentina and Grasso finally finish their never-ending rivalry. But yeah, we got a good card. I think Joaquin Buckley's fighting, right?
Yes.
Yeah, he's one of my kind of just obscurely favorite fighters, so it's always nice to see him back in the octagon. But yeah, got some good fights. It's gonna be fun. Squared, how you doing, man?
I'm doing good. I'm really excited for this weekend. Excited for Blanchfield. She's my favorite female fighter by a country mile. She fights like a dude, and I mean that as a compliment. Obviously, fucking love watching her fight. Excited also to go to Kentucky with Max. Gonna be a good weekend. Yeah.
Hell yeah. Good fight. Before we get started, I'm gonna take this shot real quick. I don't know if anybody's got a drink poured up, whatever you're drinking. Looks like Max drinking some hard ass Gatorade. Oh shit.
Dude, people will not stop shitting on me for this. The cucumber lime.
Oh bro, cucumber lime is so fucking good.
Pony crazy.
Dude, you know who
loves it. You know,
I don't think I've had it.
I just puked in my mouth after hearing.
No,
that.
Bro. No,
I don't know. I've never tried it, but I don't know if I could.
Bro, it is fucking peak. It is so good. It is so good.
Matt, you'll
Like
have to get
the
one
guy at
on
the
the
gas
trip.
station, my boy Jonathan grilled me for like 2 minutes for getting them. But dude, Brian Battle loves them. Old Pooh Bear loves them.
Yo, that's what the fuck is
He
up, my
knows
dude.
all
I
about
love
them.
me some cute in the middle of the
Also,
summer.
before we start, I do kind of just want to flex that I was the only one who got that OSP pick right. And
Oh,
I just want to I just want to say
yeah.
that one more time because I feel like we all
Unrightfully
forgot and I
so.
needed to mention it again.
OSP lost. I'm sorry.
That's fair. Hey, that's fair. But I
It was a
still can't.
it was not a robbery, but
Kennedy fucking Kennedy
I thought
fucking
Kennedy won, but I mean
Kennedy
he didn't
sold, bro.
do anything to win, so I
He sold.
can't be mad at
One of
that.
those
Losing to
things where like
OSP
you
is
were right,
insane.
but you're still dumb
Yeah.
for picking it,
Yeah,
you
for sure.
know?
I thought, yeah,
Hey.
I'm not gonna lie. I thought OSP was gonna get fucking just cooked in that fight because he's just old and like
That was
over the moon.
probably he should have retired after that fight,
Dude,
honestly.
he looked great. He looked
Sorry,
great. It was
Dre.
fucking
I'm sorry,
crazy.
Dre. Sorry, Dre.
You know what's funny is
Dre does
when
not
that
take
fight.
shit for people talking about OSP in a negative light.
Oh, do they
Dude, when that
train?
fight happened, I was thinking
Yeah,
I
they're
gotta
both out
apologize
of
to
Knoxville.
Coop.
They're out of the same gym. Yeah.
Ah, fuck.
No, he's old Vol.
Yeah.
Let's do this
Gotta
fucking.
respect my Tennessee boys, and I love them, you know.
Let's do
But
this little
cheers.
drink. Cheers,
Hey,
boys.
go Tennessee, beat Creighton. Fuck them.
Cheers.
Me and Matt will be watching from some bar in Louisville. Matt, I'm wearing my Tennessee hat tonight.
The one you always wear?
No, this is the one I always wear.
There's a lot of foam in that. Fuck me.
I'm gonna wear my Tennessee hat that night for
The
sure.
one that you almost always wear?
The other one that I wear a lot, yeah. You fucking asshole.
Okay. Dude, you so, something about that house you live in. People just be wearing the same shit every day.
I wear the same hats. I don't wear the same shit every day. Chandler wears the same shit every day. That
Fucking disgusting.
motherfucker. Those camo pants. He washes them like once every 2 months.
Right.
He
Oh,
probably
fuck.
watches and fucking attempt to be mad at me, but
What's he gonna do
yeah, I know, like 2 feet tall. Anyway,
about
first fight we want to talk about on the card, of course, is Andre Petroski and Jacob Malkoon. Andre Petroski is 10-2 as a pro. He obviously was a tough 29 competitor. He's 5-1 in the UFC. His only loss coming to Michel Pereira. He beat Gerald Meerschaerts via split decision. He beat OSP in a grappling match in the Fury Pro stuff. He beat Wellington Turman in the UFC, Nick Maximov, Yao Zhong Hu, Michael Gilmore. Actually, that wasn't in the. Yeah, it was. Yeah, that was his first. Yeah, okay. So, one's in the UFC. He's 5-1. His only loss is Michel Pereira, which is aging pretty damn good because Michel Pereira looks like a different type of fighter lately. Jacob Malkoon is 7-3 as a pro. He's 3-3 in the UFC. His wins are to Nick Maximov, AJ Dobson, Abdul Razak Al-Hassan. Maximov and AJ Dobson are both no longer in the UFC. AJ Dobson as soon as today, the recording of this podcast, March 25th. His losses are to Phil Halls, Brendan Allen, Cody Brundage. The Brendan Allen loss is a good one. The Cody Brundage and the Phil Halls ones are not. I am very much confident that Petroski is going to probably submit him via like some either a Darce or Anaconda, probably, I would say. I did not think that going into the recording of this podcast, but I looked at their Tapologies really quick before we started, and it changed my mind swiftly and promptly, and I am pretty confident that might be, I don't want to say it's my lock of the night, but it might be my lock of the night. Petroski by either Darce or Anaconda. Knuckles, what's up, buddy?
I'm kind of I was on the fence kind of going into this fight actually. I was leaning Malkoon originally and then it kind of went on the fence, but I think so watching Petroski in the past, the big thing with him is his gas tank isn't really there ever, and especially now that USADA's gone, the motherfucker's probably taking even more juice. So he's probably going to have an even worse gas tank unless he's like doing some EPO or some shit.
Walt Harris just got a 4-year suspension from the new committee, so I don't think
anybody. Okay, hey, okay, that's okay.
To be fair,
but what I will say, but what I'm saying though is that like Petrosky still has never had a good gas tank, and Malkoon is known for winning decisions. So Malkoon's only 28. His last loss was kind of a shitty situation because it was a DQ. Don't get me wrong, like yeah, it was a what, elbow to the back of the head, I believe. I think Malkoon will eke it out. I think he'll win a decision. He'll just do enough to get by. Petrosky will start gassing by the second, excuse me, by the second round. Malkoon, younger fighter, higher ceiling. People talk about him being like one of the future guys. I don't know if I see that, but I think he is going to be like a, you know, maybe top 15 type of like gatekeeper kind of guy. He's going to be pretty good. Petrosky is really good. I think Petrosky's actually a really, really great fighter, but I just think that his gas tank had me concerned. I think that Malkoon being a decision type of fighter will eke out a decision. That's my pick. So Malkoon is by decision is my pick. Coop, what do you got, brother?
Truth be told, I really don't know much about this matchup. I'm familiar a lot with Petrosky just with his work on The Ultimate Fighter. But I'm going to be honest.
Malkoon's one of Rob's boys.
One of Rob Whitaker's? Or
his primary training partner.
That's not why I'm picking him. I just want to clarify that.
I'm just letting you know. It's his primary training partner.
I wouldn't be surprised.
It has been for a few years.
But, yeah, I am kind of looking forward to this, though, just because I am a big fan of Petrosky. Just because he's one of those guys that you just fall in love with, like for whatever reason, really. So I'm just excited to see what he does. And I mean, if he loses, so be it. But if he doesn't, then great. I am picking him to win. However, I do think it's going to be by decision just because I just don't see a knockout coming. Like it's one of those like gut feelings where you just don't see a finish happening. But Squared, what you thinking, man?
I'm kind of in the same boat as you. How many losses does Malkoon have, real quick?
Three, I think. The three are if he,
I feel like I've only ever seen him lose for some reason.
No, he's won in the UFC, but he
see.
He,
I thought the same thing.
So the people
I thought the
he
same
beat,
thing.
He beat Abdul Razak Al Hassan. He beat AJ Dobson, and he beat Maximov. AJ Dobson and Nick Maximov are no longer in the UFC. Abdul Razak Al Hassan is somehow still in the UFC. His losses were to Phil Hawes, Brendan Allen, which Brendan Allen's a good loss, but he also lost to, well, yeah, he lost to Cody Brundage, but it was
grand
due
assault.
To an illegal, you know, back of the head.
Grand assault with that. So he's got,
but he also got knocked out by Phil Hawes, so that's what we have to.
But dude, Phil Hawes also, like, Phil Hawes knocked out some, like, decent. Phil Hawes is going to last cannon, bro.
Yeah.
Anyways. Yeah, no, you're good. Yeah, for some reason, like, I know he's won, but I just, anytime I picture him, it's just like a fight that he's losing. But that's just going off memory. I'm leaning more towards Petrosky in this one. I think that people are kind of looking past him after that last fight. But like you were saying, I think Michelle was just a new motherfucker right now. Yeah. He also was like fucking twice the size of Petrosky. Maybe that's more on Petrosky just being a small dude. I think it probably is, but I don't know. I think people are just kind of looking past him. Two losses, right? One to Michelle and the other being to Brian Battle, right?
That wasn't tough, but like his
But that still counts.
That one didn't.
It wasn't the final. The final.
I'll tell you why, because I think he does have two UFC losses. I could be wrong. Let me tell you for sure.
No. His other loss is in LFA. His other loss is in LFA.
Okay. Yeah.
So the battle one doesn't count in official. It counts as a exhibition.
Yeah, no, yeah, for sure. Yeah, you're
That
right.
makes
Yeah,
sense.
so he had the loss to Michelle Pereira and he had the loss to Aaron Jeffrey in Elevate.
Yeah.
All right. This is what happens when I just go off memory, but fuck it. I'm still picking Petrosky because why not?
Yeah, I agree.
I think he's fucking good. I think he really, like, honestly, of the two fighters, again, being a Rob guy, you guys know I'm a Rob guy, I actually like Petrosky
I'll
better.
be honest, I like Malcolm better than Petrosky. I don't
Really?
like Petrosky that much.
Oh, dude, I fucking love
He rubbed me the wrong way on Tough. I didn't
Max,
love
Max
his
hates
vibe.
Philly dudes, though. So.
I didn't
Hey,
love his
bro.
vibe. I'm gonna be honest. I
I
didn't.
hate
I didn't.
Philly
Well, I
too.
like Sean Brady. I like Sean Brady. I like Sean Brady.
Yeah. Sean
There's only
Brady's
one
like, he's a
person from
god man
Philly.
out of there.
There's one person from Philly
But
I
I
like.
like Paul Felder.
And that's okay. There's two people from Philly I like. That's Paul Felder and fucking Eddie Alvarez because me and Eddie Alvarez have the same
I like
birthday.
Eddie
So
Alvarez too, so there you go.
shout
Me and
out Eddie
Alvarez
Alvarez.
have the same what?
Same birthday.
Oh, that's cute. Me and Soulja
But
Boy have the same
January
birthday.
11th, baby.
Hey, me and
January
T-Pain
11th.
have the same birthday.
Me and
Oh,
Manu
okay.
Ginobili have the same birthday. How about that one?
Yo, Manu?
Yeah.
Don't know who
Me and Julio Jones have the same birthday.
Ah,
Oh, we're out here cooking, bro.
you
The best podcast in the fucking world.
Oh,
Let's
me
go.
and Dana White. Yeah.
Me and
Forgot about that one.
You and
Actually,
Dana White for real?
Yeah, July
that's
28th.
oh, dude. I mean, and you
What the
haven't
fuck?
gotten him on the podcast yet
Haven't
for
got
a
Come on,
birthday
my man,
bash?
dude. How have I not
For
gotten
a
one?
birthday bash? Dang.
Oh, fucking, I love this podcast. Dude,
Anyways, God damn
let's go, bro.
it.
What's next, bro? What's next,
Oh,
brother?
next one we're gonna talk about is apparently Knuckles request Verna Jandiroba versus Lupita Godinez. Verna is a fucking little bulldog. She's like fun to watch in her own way because she does grapple a lot, but like it's kind of fun sometimes. Like she just fucking does her thing. Sometimes she does lay and pray. I'll be honest. Sometimes she does lay and pray. When she doesn't lay and pray, she's fun. When she lays and prays, it really sucks and it's not fun for anybody. But sometimes she doesn't. On the other hand is Lupita Godinez, who is what 7-3 in the UFC, and I don't
Just
know.
beat Tabitha.
She's beat Tabitha. She's on a 4-in-a-row streak. Two of those are split decisions, though. It's a weird one, man. I don't even know. Like I don't know. Like I don't even. No, like, I want to pick Lupi because she's hot and Verna is just not. But God, dude, like, I
You
don't
don't like the
know.
bro, Max. You don't like the eye. You don't like those fucking.
No, I'm not a big fan. No, I'm
Yeah.
not a big fan that she looks like Raul Rosas Jr. I'm not a big fan that she looks exactly like Raul Rosas Jr. Not a not a not a big fan. Not a big fan of that, to be honest with you. Loopy, on the other hand, she looked pretty good.
Feel good.
God, dude, am I picking a fighter based on looks? I might just have to, cause I
That
don't
you,
know.
it's a pretty solid pick. It's a pretty solid pick.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna go Loopy. I don't know. I don't know. Who knows? I'm not betting on this fight. Knuckles is the one that wanted to talk about it. You will see my
I
bets
fucking
far
dude.
away from this fight. I will not bet on this fight because it could go either way. It's one of those, women's MMA fights. I just don't know. I hope Lupi wins, and I think she will, but you don't know. So, Knuckles, give me your dumb analysis on it because there is no analysis to be made. So.
Honestly, like I don't know why I fucking because I don't know. I don't know either because Verna's fucking good. They both are good in their own ways. I think Loopy's better on the feet than Verna is. Verna's more of a grappler. But Loopy is also a great grappler. I just want to talk about it because I just fucking love Loopy Godinez. I kinda like want her to marry me, but I mean it is what it is. We're not too far apart in age. I think actually it might be the same age, I don't remember, but
You better
this
do it before I
is
do.
my lovely, huh?
Oh.
What? 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 What?
No,
But,
you're good. You're good.
you know,
You're good.
I just fucking I love Loopy, dude. I've been a massive fan of Loopy for I think since 2018 or 2019, I saw her in an interview with maybe Ariel, maybe somebody. But I learned a lot about her, learned a lot about where she comes from. She's like a Canadian Mexican, which is pretty fucking cool. Like she's originally from Mexico, but her family, her sister wrestles for the Canadian Olympic team. Super fucking cool. I love Loopy. And I'm not just picking her based on that. I just think that overall, Verna's probably slightly better on the ground, but I think that Loopy's good enough to keep it on the feet. And I think she just has more volume and a little bit more there. And I think that's where it's going to be decided. Probably clinching. And I don't think there will be a finish at all in this fight. It'll be a decision. I think Loopy probably takes the decision. I don't know. It'd be close though. I wouldn't be surprised by a split here, but yeah. Coop, what do you got on that one, man?
I got Loopy just because I think she's looked, I mean, I don't think, but she's looked really good in her last fights. Although some of them were splits, I honestly think both of her, or like all of her split wins should have been unanimous. Like split decisions, they still really don't, I don't get them. Like they just really don't make sense, but that's a story for another time. Yeah, I think Loopy gets it done. I honestly don't know what method she does, but I just think Loopy's gonna win because she's been looking good, and she has the momentum of a four fight win streak behind her, and I think she kind of carries that through this fight. Squared, what do you think?
I'm gonna take what Knuckles said and just emphasize that like a text message. He pretty much nailed it. But going off of what you said, that you were saying like her split decision shouldn't be splits. Remind me, her split decision with Tabitha probably shouldn't have been split, right? Am I remembering that correct?
Yeah, it shouldn't have been.
Yeah, okay. That's what I remember. So going off of that, I think she's kind of on a bit of a positive swing right now, so I'm going with Loopy.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah. I love that. I'm fucking, dude. I'll spread Loopy propaganda as long as I can. I'm telling you, dude, that MMA Hour interview where like they took the fucking screenshot of her and Diego and it looks like natural born killers. She's gorgeous in her own way. Might not be everybody's cup of tea, but she is definitely my cup of tea. Also, you got to remember she did fucking submit at least Reed before that fight too. That's a pretty solid win. Max, are you alive?
Max, you're muted.
You're muted.
What's up, boys? What's
What's going on, man?
Anyways, the next one we got on the featured prelim. I don't know if you are gonna like my pick on this one, I'll be honest. I got Jamal Emmers. Jamal Emmers is fighting Nate Landwehr. I got Jamal Emmers winning, and it sucks because Nate Landwehr lives in Tennessee. He's our Tennessee boys. Jamal Emmers is 3-3 in the UFC, but if you look who he's lost to, he's lost to Giga Chikadze in a fucking split decision. He lost to Jack Jenkins in a split decision, and he lost to Pat Sabatini. He beat Vince, Cachero, which, and then Khasun Ashgabov, which, and he beat Dennis Bazooka. However, he's fighting Nate Landwehr. Nate Landwehr is 17-5. He's out of Clarksville, Tennessee. He's 4-3 in the UFC. He lost to Danny Gay most recently. Beat Austin Lingo, David Onama, and Ludovic Klein before that. He lost to Julian Arosa and won against Darren Elkins. The thing about Jamal Emmers, that man beat Corey Sandhagen back in the day. I don't know if y'all knew that. Dude's a fucking gamer, man. His only losses, he lost to Julian Arosa on the Contender Series. He lost to Giga Chikadze a split decision. Jack Jenkins a split decision. And Pat
He won that.
Sabatini.
He won that
Yeah,
jacket.
exactly.
Fucking man.
Exactly. We see what happens. I mean, listen, I love Nate Landwehr. I love him, dude. I'm following him for life. He's fun. He makes fights fun. His post interviews are fun as fuck. Nobody can deny that. He's a Clarksville, Tennessee boy. I love that too. But Dude, when he fights truly technical fighters, he loses. Let's not pretend that I know he won against Onama, but let's not pretend he was not getting dominated before Onama gassed out. You know what I mean? Like, that's what people forget because of that performance. It was so just like his comeback, his fucking perseverance, the way he won was awesome. I mean, dude, that solidified his name in MMA. But he was getting pieced the fuck up and dominated before Onama gassed out. Like, it's just on the film. Like, you can just watch it and know what was happening. And it's the same with the other fights. But so my thing is, Jamal Emmers wins. Jamal Emmers has gotten, underrated because of the competition he's lost to, but he's beat some dogs. So I think Jamal Emmers wins pretty easily. Knuckles, what do you get?
Yeah, I fucking love Nate the Train. I love the guy. I like him. He's an exciting fighter. He fought, he's fought at some high level competition. I believe he was a champion in what I think it was KSW, right? He's a good dude. Like, I mean, he's got that chaos clause. I always throw that out there. There's always that chaos clause. Like, fighters have that. He definitely has it. I agree with what you said, Max. I just think that Jamal is too technical. And I think that Jamal's also one of those guys that's like exceeded expectations in a way. I did not think he was that good. And he has proven time and time again that, like, I'm just fucking good. And I think a lot of it, it's funny, his nickname's Pretty Boy. I think a lot of it is how he looks. He just looks like an unassuming, kind of like low-key ugly-ass dude. Like, he's just an unassuming dude, and he fucking does what he does. He definitely, in my opinion, I thought won the Jack Jenkins fight. And if he beats Jack Jenkins, he probably beats Nate Landwehr. So I'm gonna have Jamal Emmers, and I think it's gonna be another decision win. Probably an intriguing fight. I don't know. It'll be an intriguing fight. I don't think it's gonna be an amazing fight, but it'll be good. But Jamal Emmers is my pick. Coop, what do you got, brother?
I am actually in agreement with you, Knuckles. I do think Jamal Emmers gets it done. And I do think it's by a decision. I think it's just one of those fights where that's one of the only things that could really happen. Because, again, I don't really see a finish coming here. And, excuse me. And there's only one other way you can end a fight if it's not by, like, finish. It's by, like, end of time. But point being, I do think Emmers is like, he's so good, man. Like, he's so damn good. And I don't think.
Got very unfavorable matchups.
Yeah. I don't think he's losing. Like, that's really my thoughts. I don't think he's losing. Squared, what you thinking?
Yeah. So Emmers is going to win the fight. That's how I feel, but unlike Benedict Schultz over here, I never pick against a Tennessee boy, so I'm willing to take it down to Volunteer State. Yeah, Landwehr by Volunteer State mentality, baby. That's all I'm gonna say. I'm fully ready to take that L. I expect to take that L, but I'm gonna do it.
I love it, dude. I love it. I love that.
I love it,
nice. Dude.
All right, this one we are not going to cook on for long. We got Chidio Njokuani versus Reese McKee. Chidio Njokuani has obviously lost his last three. He was 5-0 before that. And Reese McKee is 0-3 in the UFC. I mean, Chidi's going to win. I think Chidi's going to win. I'm just going to leave it there. Knuckles, cook if you want to.
Just real quick. I'm going to try to keep it short. I honestly don't know if Chidi's even going to fucking make weight. I thought he was kind of like an average to big middleweight, so that's number one. I think he's going to have a hard time making weight. Number two, that's going to lessen his chin. And Reese McKee.
Remember, this guy lost to Angelusa.
It's It's pretty comparable. This matchup's pretty comparable to Andalusia, honestly, because Chidi's kind of the same. You just it's fucking firepower is all it is. I got Reese McKee,
That's
honestly.
crazy.
And I think Chidi's gonna gas out. I got Reese McKee. I think honestly by
But
finish,
respectfully, you're wrong.
I think honestly by finish, I'm gonna pick Reese McKee. I'm gonna keep it at that.
That's crazy.
I'm gonna keep it at that.
Reese is gonna die, but anyways, Cooper, go ahead, my
I
brother.
fucking love Reese McKee though, but Coop, yeah, what do you got, brother? Go
My thoughts can be summarized in two sentences. Chidi's gonna win. Chidi's gonna knock him out.
Yeah,
Squid,
there
what
you
you
go.
think?
The only thing I can think of coming from Reese McKee is just suffering one of the most brutal dominations from Hamzat. So based off that alone, I'm going Chidi.
Oh yeah, that's what we like to see. Shit,
I'm
you're
just,
right.
I'm honestly not trying to be different. I don't know. Like,
Yeah, you're just wrong. It's okay.
I just think that Chidi, I think that Chidi's weight cut's gonna hurt him. I
You
think it is.
picked Elvis Brenner
You're just
as
wrong.
rookie of the year last year. You are definitely be different.
Because I'm not gonna get into this with you. We're going on. We're moving on. We're moving on. I'm gonna keep my pinky up. My pinky up, class.
He got knocked out like 5 times and then came back and won, dude. Come on.
Yeah, and he did. He won, right? Came
Yeah,
back
he
one.
got knocked out like 5 times. He'll probably be fucking retired by the end of next
But
year.
who won the fight? But
He'll
who
be
won the fight?
retired by the end of the next year.
Who won
So
the fight? Who won the fight?
him a couple times.
Fucking love you guys.
Next up, we
I
got
can't. I can't wait. I can't
Aljo
wait for.
versus Nelson, and I honestly have no fucking clue.
I can't wait for the screenshot though of me with my pinky up in my face, like next to
Actually, you know what? Can we just skip Rizzo or Algio and Nelson?
Yeah, 'cause dude, I don't
Who
fucking know.
cares?
I
Who
guess
cares? Who cares?
I was gonna pick Algio, I guess. I don't
Yeah, I
fucking
don't know. I don't know. Who
I
fucking
don't
cares?
know.
Who cares? Who cares?
Coop, you got Coop Bird, you guys got anything?
Anybody have anything specific they want to say on that one fight?
Nope.
Cool. Let's move on.
Nope.
Ruzaboyev versus Cedric. Dumbass. Let's go Nurzultan Ruzaboyev, just because the other guy's name is dumbass and not even think about it twice. Can we be in agreement on that?
Yeah, I just want to say that Ruzaboyev is gonna like. I just want to say this because again, I don't fucking like Cedric, the fucking wife beater bitch
Yeah.
ass
Tell
motherfucker.
how he's gonna beat him really fast and then we'll move
Well,
on.
dude, that's what's what I was gonna say. If Nurzultan can beat Bruno Fajeda, who Bruno Fajeda would fucking murder Cedric Dumas. That means that Ruzaboyev is probably just gonna just fucking run through this guy, like just kill him. So yeah, Ruzaboyev by murder, murder. And if Cedric surprises us, which it won't happen, you know, I guess it is what it is. But he's a wife beater. He's a fucking piece of shit. So yeah, go ahead.
All right, cool. Squirt and Koopa, I assume y'all are good on that one.
Yeah, we're fading, dumbass.
Yeah, fuck dumbass.
Fade, dumbass, till the day I die.
Bruno Silva versus Chris Weidman. I unfortunately have picked Silva just because I think Chris Weidman is done. I hope to the gods that I am wrong. I really do. But I'm probably not wrong, unfortunately. Bruno Silva is probably gonna win, and we'll just see just like a boring, dominant decision. Unfortunately, Knuckles, what you
I don't know why they made this fucking fight. I just want to say that. Why? Okay, Weidman lost to Brad Tavares, who lost to Bruno Silva.
To
Why
be
the fuck?
fair, before you say why they made it, Weidman probably asked for it. Weidman's a dog.
Fair,
He's a
fair, fair.
gamer. He probably wanted somebody to game. So, you know, all the credit to him on that. I don't even think we need to talk about that because I think that's where that came from. But
Right.
I just don't think he's there anymore.
I like
Sucks.
Blandado. Like I fucking love Blandado. Silva, I love him, but I don't even want to make a pick because I like Bruno. But I also like I love Chris. I just don't want to make a pick. It's Blindado. He's gonna win, but like I don't feel good about it. Like why this fucking why is this
Well, we
fucking
got fucking Chris Wyman right here in the bottom left corner to tell us what he thinks about it. He sure does look like him.
Does he? He doesn't have a
Kinda.
fucking shit. He doesn't have shit ton of gray in his beard, bro. Like that's
He looks like a younger Chris Wyman
he
a
does,
little bit.
dude. But I think, I mean, GM3 showed that a grappler can knock out Bruno Silva. So I mean, there's a chance. But Chris Weidman hasn't had heavy hands since literally the first fucking Silva fight. So and that was. That's what, 12, 13 years ago? Something like
Long
that.
time
Like,
ago.
but Coop, what do you got, brother? I'm gonna pick,
Whoa.
I'm picking
Okay.
Silva. I'm picking Silva, by the way, by I'm gonna fucking say probably TKO. I hate saying that. But yeah. Fuck, that hurts. Yeah, Coop, what do you got, brother?
I have a little bit of bias towards Chris Weidman because a buddy of mine is his nephew. So I always
Fire.
kind of root for him no matter what. Like he could be going up against Prime Anderson Silva as the version of himself that he is now, and I'd still root for him. But I do think that he is on the metaphorical sunset of his career. I do think it's on like the downslope, and I don't think he'll maybe get like a favorable matchup to get a win and then close out his career. But other than that, I don't really think there's going to be much positive stuff coming from Weidman going forward. That being said, I am going Bruno Silva via decision. Squared, what you thinking?
I think there's not a whole lot to say. Like y'all were saying, Weidman's definitely on the tail end. I don't see him having more than like, I mean, this could easily be his last fight. That wouldn't surprise me, but
It should be. It should be.
yeah. That leg snap should have been his last fight, to be honest. But Silva's good. He's kind of had a rough patch these couple last few fights, but before that, before the Poatan fight, the dude meant something. He was dangerous, and still is. So I'm picking him probably by TKO.
A lot of people thought he won that Alex Pereira fight too, so keep that in mind.
It was a good one. It definitely tested Alex for sure.
If you go
That's
watch it, if you go back and watch it, or have once, and I was like, there's an argument there for Silva to win that
That
fight.
and that's the thing.
It
That's the
truly
thing,
is.
dude. It's like Blindado's been like fucking. He that I will give credit like or like some credence to Weidman going into this fight. Blindado's not young either. Like he's what, like 36, 35, you know, like it's just I just think he has too much all around.
Yeah, it'd be.
I mean the only fight that I can't explain why the fuck he lost is the GM3 fight. I still don't know.
Yes.
How do you
I
get knocked
mean,
the fuck out by Gerald?
MMA. MMA, brother. MMA,
Hey,
brother.
Chris, what, Chris? Hey, brother. Go ahead. Go ahead, brother.
Moving on to the co-main event that was supposed to be the main event originally. We're talking about Vicente Luque versus Joaquin Buckley. As far as I know, I believe y'all just confirm real quick. It's 3 rounds, I think. I don't think it's five. Three.
Yeah, it's three.
Cool.
Let me look
Yeah.
at the. Let me hold on.
I mean, I'm almost certain.
It's
Oh,
three, I'm pretty sure.
it is 3 5-minute rounds. I just looked.
I don't think Buckley would want five.
Vicente Luque, I think, will win this one. I just think he's game and just been there longer, can do more things technically than Joaquin can. Buckley is he's got power, he's got tenaciousness, but I don't think that's gonna be enough to beat a Luque based off where their skill sets are. I think you could see maybe even a Luque like Anaconda or Darce finish because he loves those. But I think Duke or Luque wins either by decision or submission in like the second round. Knuckles, what do you got, man?
Man, I like this fight a lot. I think it's chaos versus chaos because people a lot forget about Luque, prime Luque. Again, I think he's past his prime, but prime Luque was the chaos merchant, dude. He just kind of like he's either gonna darce your ass or he's gonna throw some spinning shit or he's gonna do this or that. But then you also have Joaquin Buckley, who is the owner of probably the best knockout in UFC history. So it's like chaos versus chaos. I think Buckley's a little bit more raw. That being said, I also think that Luque has a little bit more well-rounded game. We saw on the Dos Anjos fight, which Dos Anjos is a legend, but Luque just out-grappled his ass. But RDA is a 155er, and Buckley's kind of like more of a true 170er. So it'll be a tough fight. I think it'll be a good fight, but I agree. I think Luque will secure a finish here. I think it'll be a submission. I think he's going to take him down, and I think we might see a classic anaconda or yeah. I think I'm gonna say an anaconda. I think we're gonna see an anaconda out of Luque. If it's not an anaconda, it's like Max said, it might be a darce. But I think I'm leaning anaconda. I think we're gonna see a
Very, very similar submissions, but yeah, for
pretty
sure.
much the same fucking submission, just depending on you. But yeah,
Pretty sure the
anaconda, anaconda.
angle was just swap, but
Yeah, it's angle swap. That's it. All it is. But I'm gonna go either one. They're basically yeah, either one, either one. Yeah, Luke submission. I'm gonna say second to third. Cooper, what do you got, brother?
remember how I said earlier, I think in the intro, that Joaquin Buckley is one of like my favorite kind of like obscure fighters? Before I get into that, I actually just kind of remembered my talking point. I don't know how many of you guys are familiar with like the latest in professional wrestling, but there is a term going around called a double main event. This feels like a double main event card. Like, 'cause this doesn't feel like a co-main event if you really think about it, because you got Vicente Luque, who has a resume only rivaled by like the greats of the division, and Joaquin Buckley, although he is very young, he is very fucking good. Like, he is really, really good. Like Knuckles said, he's the owner of probably the greatest knockout of all time in
He's
UFC.
one dimensional, but he's good.
What do you think? His striking is
I
fucking
said
insane.
he's one dimensional, but he is good.
I do think that the cut down to 170 for Buckley was one of the better decisions that he's made in his career.
100%. Oh yeah, he
Compared
was way too
to, I
small.
think it was either his last fight at 185 versus Chris
Remember the way he
Lewis.
looks against fucking Kevin Holland? I mean, that's all you gotta
Yeah.
look at.
Yeah.
It was his last fight at 185 versus Chris Curtis, where he actually got finished, where I was like, yeah,
Yeah, that was the fight. That was the fight.
he needs to go down a weight class. And
Yeah.
he did. He looks great. And I'm honestly excited to see where this goes. This may be a hot take, but I'm going Joaquin Buckley by late round knockout.
I like it because you fucking dude, after you cooked with that OS, you cooked on like a couple picks, but you cooked on the OSP pick. I like it. I like the hot take. It's good, man. Because it
Yeah.
could happen.
Yeah, it sparks
No, I
a.
mean, I don't think it's too crazy.
But
Again,
I do think
okay.
that fight can honestly go either way.
You
But
gotta
I do see Buckley getting it done.
remember though too, like where Coop's pick really comes in is that Luque had that brain bleed. So
Yeah, no, for sure. It did.
it really
Yeah.
factors.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Squared, what do you got, bud?
Kind of going off what Knuckles had just mentioned, for the longest time, Luque was kind of known as one of those iron chins, but that's kind of questionable now. Not that I'd see him getting like flash KO'd by just anybody, but Buckley, that could happen. Buckley's dude hits like a fucking missile. That being said, even though Luque's a little rougher around the edges these days. I do think he's past his prime, which is pretty unfortunate because he's like, what, 31, 32 maybe? Something like that. I think he'll utilize his grappling well. I think he'll utilize his veteran status. I don't know. I'm looking for a word, but his experience, and I think he'll win it via his grappling, whether that's a submission or just kind of controlling his way to a decision. I prefer a submission just because that's a little more exciting, but I think he gets the W.
Hell yeah.
Oh yeah. All right.
Good pick. What's good picks, boys?
Moving on. This fight, I mean, as far as women's MMA goes, this is the not non-title wise.
This
We
is
gotta
act.
stop
This
and we gotta stop and look at this as like one of the
this
best.
it's the title, bro.
this
The,
is
no, this is for the title. If
it,
we're being real,
this
this is
is
for the
one of
title.
the best non-title women's fights that we've ever seen in UFC history. I'll
A
be
quick
honest.
question, for the group before we go into the pick.
Yeah.
Do you think whoever wins this fight goes on to beat either Grasso or Vol?
I do.
Yeah.
Yes,
Either one, either
absolutely.
one, either one, either
Absolutely.
one.
Yeah.
Yes, either
Yep,
one,
yep, yep,
yes.
yep. I mean, we're talking about a generational, and you know, this people say what you want about women's MMA. I do the same thing from time to time. It's not the most entertaining thing a lot of the times, but this fight right here, I'm telling you
Is
right now,
entertaining.
this is the pinnacle of what we can get from them. Because I mean,
Yeah.
we're talking about Manon Fiorot is 11-1 in MMA. Aaron Blanchfield is 12-1 in MMA. This is clearly a title contention fight. Aaron Blanchfield is 6-0 in the UFC. Manon Fiorot, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, is 6-0 in the UFC. Both of them have beat legends of the division. Manon Fiorot has beat Rose Namajunas, Jennifer Maya, Myra Brano Silva, Tabitha Ricci. Dogs. Like, I mean, I'm talking dogs. And then Aaron Blanchfield has beaten, we're talking Tyler Santos, who most people argued that beat Valentina Shevchenko. I was one of those people. I thought she did. She beat Jessica Andrade. She beat Molly McCann, which Molly McCann, obviously, you know, she Khamira'd her. Molly McCann's not a defensive expert, but she beat Miranda Maverick, JJ Aldrich. We're talking about, like, women in the division that are respected. Like women in the division that people actually come out to see that these girls have beaten. So it is, at least in the last 4 years, in my opinion, one of the best matchups between women that is not a title fight.
And to think this shit was gonna be the co-main event of the card.
Right, bro. Right,
Well,
bro.
to Luque
It
and
was supposed to
Brady,
be. Honestly,
it was supposed to be Luque and Brady.
can I be honest though? I think this fight's better than Luque and Brady. Can I be honest?
I probably would have put Sean Brady and Luque over this. But to, you know, both of y'all's argument, that's what I'm doing. This is a banger fight. This is not a placeholder main event. This is not a Holly Holm main event. This is a fucking main event. This is a good main event. This is a banger. This is, you know, if they're gonna make a woman's main event, this is the one to make. So I get people's hate on it, and I'm one of the people that hates on it sometimes, I'll be honest. But this one is fucking good. And I am struggling to pick a fucking winner. I am picking Aaron Blanchfield, but dude, it's a fucking tough one, you know? It's gonna be rough. It's gonna be a good fight, I think. I think it'll be the biggest test of Blanchfield's career, and I think she'll will show up. I think it'll be a fun fight for grapplers to watch. If you like striking only, you might not like it, but I think it's gonna be some high level grappling exchanges, maybe some cool, you know, striking exchanges. But I think that this is going to go down as one of the best women's main events that we've ever seen. I really do. Because I mean, on paper, on talent wise, in our generation, this is one of the best fight night women main events we've ever seen. And I know that's not saying a ton, but I mean, dude, just look at their Look at their resumes going into this fight. Just look at it. 6-0, both of them. 6-0 going into it, and they both beat legends in the UFC, you know, sphere. So I don't know. It should be a good one. Knuckles, sorry. I didn't mean to cook it along.
Oh, you're all good, bro. Dude, don't say sorry. You cook, bro. Man, dude, like, this fight. Initially, I was like, oh, fuck yeah. Like, Aaron's got this in the bag, you know. But Manon, she's a good fucking fighter. She's a little bit older. She's 34. Aaron's, like, 24. It's a, dude, 10-year age gap. Holy shit. Fuck. But also, Manon has a shit ton of kickboxing experience. And again, she's fought hard competition. Rose Namajunas, Caitlin Chukagian. Sorry, Caitlin Sermonara, whatever the fuck you want to call her. Jennifer Maya. So she's had competition against tough fighters and won, but Aaron Blanchfield has as well. I would argue that Aaron's one fight against Tyler Santos is kind of tougher than almost anybody that Manafro has fought, but Manon has had more overall competition. It's just such a good fucking fight. And the one shout out I want to give is the fact that Manon's one loss in professional MMA competitions to Leah McCourt, who is a legend in women's MMA. Leah's been around for a while. Again, she's not got a lot, but again, women's MMA is young, so there a lot of them don't have big records. It's fucking tough. I think Aaron gets it done. I just think that Manon's fucking huge. That's my thing, is like, we saw it in the Rose fight. Manon is a massive flyweight. Like, Manon could fight at bantamweight. I really think she could. And she would probably be champion right now, because that division sucks just ass cheeks. That division sucks ass cheeks bad. Fucking Aaron Blanchfield could probably be champion. And she's kind of like an average size to smaller flyweight. You know, probably average size flyweight. But like, man, it's tough as fuck. But Aaron Blanchfield is also another one of my future wives. So, no, square.
Claim that one. No, claim that one.
Okay. Hey, I'll take Loopy. You can have Aaron. That's fair. That's fair. Fucking, dude, Aaron Blanchfield, dude. Yeah, I got to pick Aaron Blanchfield, dude. Based off of youth, based off of grappling. Grappling is like, when it comes to MMA, dude, unless you are so superior at takedown defense, grappling is like the best. It's so good. And Manon Fiorot isn't Chuck Liddell with those fucking sprawling brawls. She's not fucking, yeah, I always go to Chuck Liddell. She's not Chuck Liddell with those sprawling brawls. She's good, but she ain't no Chuck Liddell. So Aaron Blanchfield's gonna get the job done. I'm gonna say finish. I'm gonna fucking say a finish. That's tough coming off of somebody who's legit only lost once, and it was like, what, by decision. I'm gonna say Aaron Blanchfield late TKO or submission in the fourth or fifth round. Aaron Blanchfield. Coop, what you got, brother?
Both Max and Knuckles touched on this, but this is the top of the mountain for women's MMA that does not have a title on the line. I mean, it basically does, because it's a title eliminator, but besides the point, this is...
They're both, either one of them would beat Grasso and Shevchenko. Changed my mind. Go ahead.
This may just be bias, but I think that Grasso versus Blanchfield may be one of the greatest women's fights of all time.
But you said Grasso versus Grasso Blanchfield?
Yeah. Besides the point, Aaron Blanchfield is a... Excuse my language, but she's a fucking amazing grappler. And she showed that. She finished Jessica Andrade inside two rounds. She hung with arguably the best grappler in that division that isn't her, in Tyler Santos, and won a decision that although it was really close, and I do think the judges got it right, it was a brawl. Like, that showed that she had the potential to dig down and just brawl with some of the better, like, women in that division. That division is just full of, it's so underrated. I know Knuckles kind of like crapped on it, but I feel like that division is so, like,
Wait,
it's
bantamweight?
oh no,
No,
flyweight.
I should have, dude. No, I was shitting on bantamweight. Flyweight, it's fucking great. Flyweight and strawweight's great. Bantamweight sucks ass. But yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, my biggest thing, like, this will be the make or break difference. If Erin Blanchfield has not touched up her striking to even like a moderate ability, then she will not win. Because Fiorot is, like Knuckles mentioned, she has a shit ton of kickboxing experience, and that will be the difference. If we get the Blanchfield that showed up against Andrade, she's winning. If we get the
Oh,
Blanchfield that showed up against Santos, then I don't think she's winning.
man,
I will.
I think
Not,
I would counter that
wait.
really quick. I would counter that with I think Blanchfield's wrestling will overpower
Well, no, but what I was gonna
Fiorot's
say is he
kickboxing.
had a
But
good
anyway.
point. He said the Blanchfield showed up against Andrade. I don't know if anybody. I'm not trying to overstep Coop or anybody. I'm gonna let you guys cook, but I want to say that. The Blanchfield that showed up against Andrade shows up, she's going to get clipped because this is what she was doing. She was throwing forward with no fucking, like, she wasn't fucking, like, there's none of this. It was literally Ronda
Yeah.
Rousey fucking
Hey.
striking. She was just doing this. She
Sometimes it
has to tighten
works.
that up because the
Listen.
only time it's ever fucking worked was against McCann, but Molly McCann
Yeah.
fucking sucks. But go ahead,
Cream.
Coop. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Yeah, what I was saying was the that will be if Erin hasn't tuned up that version of her striking, then she's not winning. Like, simple enough. I know, Max, you said that her grappling is good enough. I've never really been a believer that grappling is the only thing you need. I think it's incredibly important, and if you have a good base for grappling, you'll be incredibly successful in the MMA scene. But I do think you need to be at least very good in one thing, or an average at another, or just kind of like pretty good at both in order to be successful. That being said, I am taking Erin Blanchfield by decision. I don't think this fight ends in a finish. I know I've kind of said that for most of the fights on the card, but I do think that it'll be like one of those brawls and brawls that'll go 5 rounds. We'll see basically some of everything, really. And it'll be the test to truly see, although Blanchfield now has 2 top 10 wins under her belt, that if she is truly ready to take that next step and go take on Val or Grasso. Frankly, I thought she should have gotten the title shot after Val versus Grasso, the first one. But you know how Dana White books his fighters, and they
But
never.
we're kind of happy though, right? Kind of happy
Yeah.
that we got this right. Yeah.
Yeah. But
Yeah.
yeah, I'm taking Blanchfield by decision. I think she gets it done in kind of like a brawly and broody fashion. And I wouldn't be surprised if it's like a 48-47, but yeah. Squared, what you thinking?
Want to start off by saying this is a super exciting fight, and I'm gonna sound like a hater, but sometimes when you see these female main events, it's like, I don't even know if I should say names, but I will. You get like, the Hills versus Derns, and you're just like, all right, sure, whatever. But this one, you're
What?
like, oh, this is like a good one. Like, this is legit. So I'm really excited about this one. I think it'll be a really good fight. I think both fighters will have moments throughout the fight. I'm gonna, as far as my pick, I'm gonna try to suppress my bias a little bit. That's gonna be a little difficult. I'm definitely picking Blanchfield. just watching her career right now, I feel like she's making all the right moves and just like doing all the right things. Like almost that energy that she's got and the way she's kind of blazing her own trail. I feel like she's just doing all the right things to set herself up perfectly for the title shot. Obviously her last fight was a tough test, but it was the kind of test that you learn a lot from. And I expect her to have done that and go into this fight 10 times the fighter she was last time she stepped in. I'm picking her probably by a submission, later rounds. I kind of, now this is definitely my bias. This is probably more what I want to see than what it might happen, but I kind of see her just getting one of her really well-timed takedowns, getting that top pressure. She might even get a ground and pound TKO rather than a submission, but one of those two. That's how I see her winning it.
Kind of agree with that. See either getting like a head and arm choke or maybe some
Yeah.
like just like I could see her getting like full mount and then Fiorot rolling to her back and just like
I'm
curling up
thinking,
and then just
right.
ground and pound, you know.
I'm kind of like low key thinking it's pretty rare, but I'm thinking like one of those crucifix, like fucking crucifix, and maybe working into a
Yeah.
Fimura or even fucking like elbows. You know what I'm saying?
Elbow,
Like
yeah, I can see
that's
that.
what I'm
Yeah.
picturing. Yeah, because the way you neutralize a grappler like that. They're decent. Don't get me wrong. Fro has decent takedown defense, but the way that you neutralize it because they have no fucking clue how to work their lower body and shit, especially in grappling, is you get them in a crucifix because they don't know what to do. They're just like they're trying to fucking kick their legs around, and all you do is fucking just hammer down. But yeah,
Hell yeah.
I'm such a good fighter. Such a good fighter. Such a good fighter.
Absolutely. It's a good card, man. I mean, in general, man, we got some bangers on that card. I mean,
Underrated.
yeah, Aaron Blanchfield, Manny Fiorot. I mean,
Underrated.
from top to bottom, we've got some good fights. Jacob Malkoon, Andre Petroski. We've got Julio Arce and Herbert Burns. We didn't talk about that one, but that's a good fight.
I thought that
Vernon
one was
June.
good too. I thought that was a good
That's a good
fight too,
burn.
yeah.
That's a good fight. That's a good fight. Verna Jandaruba, Lupe Godinez, Nate Landwehr, Jamal Emmers, Chidi Njokuani, Reese McKee, Bill Algeo, Cal Nelson, Nurzultan Ruzaboyev versus Cedric Dumbass. I won't pronounce his name right. I refuse to. Bruno Silva versus Chris Weidman, Vicente Luque and Joaquin Buckley, and Aaron Blanchfield and Manon Fiorot. I mean, come on, dude. That's a pretty good
It's
card
a good fight,
for
bro.
a.
It's a good
I mean,
fight.
it's not even a Apex card. So I mean, that's a damn good card.
Bro, I'd buy I'd if it
I'm
was
excited.
if it was near me, I'd buy tickets for it.
Yeah,
I'm not gonna
I'd go see that one for sure. But hell, you want to wrap this thing up?
Yes, boys.
Hell
I'll
yeah.
do a fucking I'm gonna do an ice cold shot just to do it for the crowd. Just gonna hurt. It's gonna fucking hurt, but
Probably will not drink anymore, but
No, you're all good. You're all good. I'm just doing it for the
no,
gram.
I feel
The
it for sure.
gram.
Again, like I say every time, we appreciate everybody that sits here and watches us talk our fucking nonsense. Sometimes we're smart, sometimes we're fucking stupid, but we always have a good time, and I feel like people that watch us have a good time with us, and we like that. That's kind of our vibe. Give us a like. Give us a comment on YouTube if you can. Give us a subscribe on YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, wherever you get your podcast. We love all the attention we get, man. I mean, you guys are awesome. In a little over a year, we never expected this thing to go this far. I say this every fucking episode, but I'll continue to say it every single time because we do appreciate you guys this much. I mean, can't express it in words. You guys are awesome. So, thank you so much, Knuckles. You want to say some words to close out the thing?
Man, I just fucking love this shit, dude. I love this shit. I fucking love talking fights with you guys. Me and Max, again, some of it might make it into the pod, but we cooked for like fucking hour just talking about bullshit. And it was about fighting. That's what I love about this shit. I can just come in here with my boys, Talk about fighting. We can talk about fucking, dude. Me and Coop were talking about Godzilla versus King Kong earlier. So, dude, that like we can fucking talk about whatever, dude. That's what I love about this shit. That's what I love about this podcast. What I love about the people that watch this, because I know the people that watch this, y'all are just people like us. Y'all just fucking shit posting masters on the Twitter just like us. Y'all are just fucking you guys are just coming in here to listen to some shit. And I fucking love you guys. And for that, you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna fucking close her out with a little fucking hope and a prayer and a fucking. I'm probably gonna spill this everywhere because it's gonna be ice cold, but I'm gonna do a little snorkel for you guys because I love you guys. And I'm known as the fucking madman, so here we go.
Sorry, I have to follow that, Cooper, but Cooper, you want to give your closing statements, my man?
Yeah,
Cooper, what do you got?
I had to follow that. There's an expression that I like to use, like whenever I'm doing just like stuff that I like just feel kind of privileged to do. It's like I get to do this. Like we truly do get to just speak about MMA, and for some reason people listen, and we're grateful for all of you who do decide to tune in. And yeah, we got some. Bourbon and Buds are gonna be. This is gonna be a big year for this podcast, and I'm really excited to see where it goes. So, squared.
Yeah, to kind of go off what all y'all were saying, super appreciative of this platform. Super appreciative of y'all for having me on to it, which was a risky gamble y'all took because what the hell are y'all thinking? But here I am. It really is like a privilege. It's really dope. Even if we didn't have the platform, even if this was just like us hanging out, it's still a fucking good time. Me and Max are gonna have a blast this weekend in Kentucky in a month. Not even a month, but 3 weeks. Knuckles is gonna be here. We're gonna have a damn good time. It's just really cool that we get to have a good time and then we get to like turn that into something we're passionate about even more. And we've got big things planned here, and it involves those things, and just I don't know. This is really exciting, really awesome to be part of this. And thanks to everybody.
It's cool to have people that are behind us just having a good time. You know what I'm saying? Like we're just having a good time, and people like it, and people
Dude,
fucking want to
that's what I
do
tell you,
it.
dude. We're just like I feel like we're just the working man's podcast. We
Exactly.
ask we when we interview fighters, we just ask the shit that people like
Wanna know?
want to know. Like, what's your favorite fight? What
What do
like
you be
me
doing?
my dumbass question, like my dumbass question. What do you eat after you weigh in? Like shit. Like
Absolutely.
we ask basic questions. We're the working man's podcast, dude. We're just regular fucking guys. We're not sitting here like, ooh, what's like, hey brother, what like, what do you think? How do you think you'd match up versus Dustin Poirier? Like, no, we don't fuck
Yeah.
like we're
Hey.
just asking basic shit, but we love you guys.
Keep in touch for some vlogs from LFA 180 out there in Louisville this weekend. It's much love always. I cannot wait till UFC 300 where we're all sitting there in Nashville. Starting with this weekend in Louisville. Me and Square will be making some putting something together. Well, I mean, we'll take some videos or something, and
Figure it out.
yeah, something will happen. Try to network as much as we can, but. Oh, God damn it. Love it. Love it. Love it. Love it. I couldn't ask, to be a part of a better fucking team right here. So much love to the next one. Boys, it's been a good time.
Every day I spend my time drinking wine, feeling fine, waiting here to find the sign that I am. So every day I spend my time drinking wine, feeling fine, waiting here to find the sign that I should take it slow.